All right. Now I'd like us to move into the second panel discussion of the day. This discussion will be about non-dilutive funding for early academic startups. Julius, I'll pass it off to you.
Thanks, Anne-Marie. Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Julius Corley, and I will be the moderator for this session, Non-Dilutive Funding for Early Academic Startups. I'm the Director of Entrepreneurship and Strategic Partnerships for the College of Engineering here at the University of Delaware, but I'm also extremely proud to be the co-director of the recently announced NSF Northeast I-Corps Hub. Let me just say this now, you'll hear more from my friend and colleague, Christina. Our hub will embrace diversity and inclusion, not in words, but in actions. We have some great topics to discuss here, and we're thrilled to answer your questions. Please use the Q&A feature, and we will immediately answer your questions nearing the end of the session, about the last 10 or so minutes of the discussion. So now let's begin with some brief introductions from my fellow panelists. Andre, you're up first. Andre, you're muted.
Thank you for that. So my name is Andre Marshall. I am really pleased to be here and really excited about this NSF I-Corps Hub. Currently, I am the Vice President for Research, Innovation, and Economic Development at the George Mason University, and formerly an NSF I-Corps Program Director.
All right, up next, Krista.
Hello, everybody. My name is Krista Pawlowski, and I am the co-founder and COO of a therapeutics company based out of Cleveland, Ohio, called Haima Therapeutics. I also run operations on two other startup companies, SAFEX, which is a cancer vaccine company, and Alinair Therapeutics, which is developing novel biologics for cardiopulmonary diseases.
Trina?
Yeah, hello. So I'm Trina Renze. I'm a distinguished professor of biomedical engineering at the New Jersey Institute of Technology. And I'm also a co-founder of a startup company based on research in my area of medical device development for orthopedic applications. So we've licensed four patents to the startup company. And I'm also lead PI of a newly awarded NSF Advanced Grant, which is dealing with commercialization activities, increasing diversity of the faculty participating in that.
And last but not least, Christina.
We knew that in order of your least favorite to favorite panelist, Julius.
I was trying for something like that.
Hi, everyone. I'm Christina Pelican. I'm glad to be here with you today. I have been an entrepreneurial educator and coach for nearly the past decade. I have been an I-Corps instructor for the NSF for the past 8 years or so. And through that role, I've taught hundreds of deep tech startups around the world at this point. I just recently left my position at NSF, where I was working part-time alongside Andre and others. In that role, I screened hundreds of pitches that came in through the SBIR's TTR portfolio, specifically in the chemical, energy, and biological tech areas. And separately from that, I've been an NSF SBIR STTR reviewer for 8 or so years. As far as my actual roles, my full-time gigs, I was the director of commercialization at University of Delaware alongside Julius in the Entrepreneurship Center there. I managed a few programs, one of which was a $2 million proof of concept fund. And I bring this up because I was able to help a number of those startups raise a lot of mostly non-dilutive funding, about $12 million in the few years that I was there. I was also the co-PI and instructor for the I-Corps site at University of Delaware. And I, before that, was able to help launch the NSF I-Corps node out of New York City. These days, I'm COO and co-founder at Lignolix, which is a specialty chemical startup that spun out of UD. And at that company, in the past 2 years or so, we've raised $3 million in non-dilutive funding. So I'm glad to be here with you all, and I will soon be the lead instructor of the new Northeast I-Corps Hub, which I'll tell you a little bit about in a few minutes.
Great, thanks, Christina. Thanks, fellow panelists. Joe, can you load the deck, please? So let's get started. I mentioned my current roles, but what I failed to mention was that I'm an entrepreneur as well. I've been involved with a couple of different startup companies, one of which went public, IPO, fully acquired by Johnson & Johnson just last year. So it was an exciting ride. But I also co-founded my own startup, Affinity Therapeutics. And I actually did that in 2010, shortly after NSF iCor was birthed. So NSF iCor was very influential for me running my company, and it helped me to avoid many of these top reasons that startups fail that you see on this very sheet. So Andre, the first question is to you. What is NSF iCor? Why was it created, and how's the program doing?
So thanks for your question, Julius. I'll talk off of the next slide to provide an overview for iCor. So iCor is a program that really is focused on accelerating the readiness of nascent ventures to transition their tech out of the laboratory. It's to accelerate the readiness of perhaps teams and for sure individuals to get their discoveries out of the laboratory and into good use. The program began in 2011, and it was based on Steve Blank's course at Stanford, where he was teaching in the lean startup methodology. And this lean startup methodology the key insight of this methodology is that startups are not small companies. They're actually customer search engines. If you don't have customers, you don't have a company. So that's a key insight, really, of the program, is that startups absolutely need to be focused on customers, what they need, what they value, and how to find them and deliver that value to them. iCor was a great program because it really institutionalized this lean startup methodology. The first government agency to do this was NSF, and now iCor is embraced and adopted by 8 federal agencies. In fact, it is written into law. So this is a congressionally mandated program, and it's been highly impactful. So this program really changed the way that I saw myself as an academic. I participated within the first year of the program. Currently, iCor has graduated over 2,000 teams, and I was team number 83, and I was really proud of that. But I think actually Julius beat me on the team number. I believe it was maybe 12, is that? I don't know if that's right, but it's really, really early on in the process. So iCor is it's a community, and it's really a transformative experience. And so I talked about the program. iCor is also, it's a pretty complex program for NSF in that we teach researchers, and we do that through a national innovation network, which currently consists of hubs. These hubs, they provide education, infrastructure, and research. And they're pretty large grants, and they consist of several universities. And the hubs then work with teams. They work with teams at the regional level, and ultimately they work with teams at the national level. And we have the TEAMS program, which is the national program where you receive $50,000 in order to participate in a 7-week boot camp where you will really have a transformational experience, and your experience will be led by iCor instructors who are deeply experienced entrepreneurs who invest their time and talent working with you and your nascent venture. And as Christina mentioned, She is an I-Corps instructor and soon to be the lead instructor for the new hub. And I think that takes me to, I'm finished with that discussion there. So thanks for your question, Julius.
Thanks, Andre. And I was actually cohort number two there. So I beat you by a lot, buddy. Christina, you're up next. Why don't you introduce the Northeast Hub and speak to a little bit about what we're going to do there?
Sure. Yeah. So if we can show the slide of the next slide. So these are all the hubs that were just awarded. And we're really excited to be part of the inaugural round of I-Corps hubs that NSF just funded. We were just able to announce this a couple weeks ago, so it's very fresh. And we won't launch until January of 2022, but we're obviously already getting started and preparing for that launch. And when I say we, it's led by Princeton University, specifically Rod Priestley is a co-director, as well as Julius is a co-director. And our partner institutions are University of Delaware and Rutgers. And we have a number of affiliates and some more that we can't officially tell you about yet, but some exciting ones to join very soon. But the current ones we have are NJIT, Lehigh, Temple, Rowan, and Delaware State University. And as some of you might know, NJIT, where Trina's at, and University of Delaware and Rutgers are all already existing I-Corps sites. The Node Insight program was the previous structure the NSF had used, and now we're archiving that and going into the hub model. So we have some existing infrastructure already there where we know how to run these I-Corps programs. We have some really great instructors, a number of years of experience in doing these regional programs. And then we also have Delaware State University, who has been a part of the University of Delaware I-Corps site, and DSU is an HBCU, which is very exciting to be able to bring in, some very heavy diversity, great heavy hitters as far as universities. So we're really excited to launch this, like I said, January, but while we have a number of universities that are committed to being part of the hub, researchers from any institution, anywhere across the country really, are welcome to participate in our hub activities. We're all virtual, as you can imagine. So especially while we're all virtual, we're going to be running regional cohorts that are all on Zoom or maybe Google Classroom. We're still playing around with some curriculum models, but we welcome any deep technology ventures from any research institution to participate. And what that would look like is a short version of what Andre and Julius went through, this I-Corps Teams program. That's kind of like the major leagues of I-Corps. But before that, a lot of researchers go through and are encouraged to go through these short regional courses, which go by a number of different names, but you could just think of them as like the minor leagues of I-Corps. So ours will be 2 to 4 weeks. We have a number of different site models that we're kind of pulling best practices from. So it'll be a much shorter version of the National I-Corps Teams program. You'll have to do about 15 or so customer interviews, and excitingly, you'll get $3,000 from our $15 million award to go through the program. And that would help you to do some customer discovery, go to conferences, meet with potential customers and learn about your market opportunity. So it's really an exciting opportunity for researchers from around the country, but obviously we're focusing on the Northeast. We're also looking for well-qualified instructors and mentors to help teach these programs. We're going to be running a lot of regional programs. We're going to be running a number of national programs as well. And we want to bring in some really diverse talent so that, our researchers see themselves in the instructor team as well. Our central tenet is that we are a democratized leadership model, meaning that as you see, Julius is at University of Delaware, Rod is at Princeton, and those are the two co-directors. We also have, a lot of input from our affiliates as to how we want to run this a very transparent model. So it's very different and exciting than what I've kind of seen in the I-Corps, culture before. The other part of the culture that has shifted across the nation is that the ethos of the I-Corps teams, the national program, is that we are respectfully direct rather than relentlessly direct. So if any of you have been through the national program, have heard from anyone who has been through it, it's a really tough program. As instructors, we were told, stand up, pound your fists on the table, make sure that you make your point, yell at the teams, and that really put teams in a very uncomfortable place, especially if you already feel like you don't belong in the room. It makes you feel even more so that you have a negative spotlight on you. So we've definitely adjusted the culture and ethos in the past year or so to be respectfully direct. So very kind, but still telling you what you need to hear. So I'll leave it at that. If you want to get involved in our hub activities, either as an instructor or mentor, or as a team that would go through our regional program and you know, get that $3,000 grant and then eventually graduate into the national program, which comes with a $50,000 grant, please do send me an email. This doesn't go directly to me, but those emails that go to this info@icorenortheasthub.org get forwarded over to me. So I'm looking forward to hearing from you. If you go to the next slide, I'll just conclude with kind of putting this all into a continuum so you can see it all on one slide. So you invent something, ideally then you would de-risk the market potential in a short course, in a regional I-Corps hub course now. And then you would go into a national NSF I-Corps teams program, the 7-week, $50,000 program. And then at that point, you make a decision. You don't have to commit to a startup at any of these points in time. But after the I-Corps teams program, you're more or less in a good place to understand if you want to go forward as a startup, or if you just want to license your technology, your IP, to an existing company. If that's the better business model, that's great. You're welcome to do that. Or if you realize you hate doing this entrepreneurship stuff and it's not for you, then you can make a no-go decision, rinse and repeat, come back with some really great invention in the future and see if that excites you more. And then if you do go on to form a startup, obviously SBIR is something we encourage. And then there's the PFI grant, accelerators, incubators, et cetera. And you can kind of see what goes on from there. And of course, none of this is necessarily linear, but it's kind of the way that we would hope that you would systematically de-risk the market opportunity of your invention. Julius, I'll turn it back to you.
Thanks, Christina. So Andre, Krista, you all have had many different hats in terms of university technology commercialization. Andre, from your standpoint at NSF, can you give us a brief overview of NSF's goals for non-dilutive funding?
So yeah, thanks for the question, Julius. So, you know, while I was at NSF, you know, we looked at this non-dilutive funding as an opportunity for entrepreneurs to get some support to de-risk their technology, really. And we understood that this funding would be needed in order to make to support the commercialization and to make their technology more attractive to investors. And, you know, the non-dilutive aspect, so we didn't take any equity because we wanted to attract as many entrepreneurs to the table as we could, and we wanted to attract as many investors to the table as we could. And so, you know, from NSF's standpoint, we really felt like these entrepreneurs needed this support in order to keep their nascent ventures alive and to reduce the risk window. So this is really, really, really early stage. So, you know, our funding, you know, it just covers the de-risking of the technology. So it doesn't cover operations, you know, it doesn't cover marketing, none of that stuff. It's really focused on the technology and the types of companies that NSF supports, you know, are deep technology companies. So those are companies and technologies that stem from research in engineering and the sciences, and, you know, specifically from university-based research. And so those types of technologies is especially important to have the time and the financial support to help those technologies mature and keep them to check to see if they're viable and to keep them advancing in preparation for either investment, in preparation for contracts, for sales, whatever it may be.
Okay, so we're talking about the development and commercialization of these technologies. So Krista, could you paint a picture of the different roles involved in creating and growing a startup? And how do you leverage this funding that Andre was just talking about?
Yeah, absolutely. I think to kind of spark this a startup, it really takes what I would consider an entrepreneurial lead, which is a term that's used in the iCorps program. It's that person, boots on the ground, has the passion, has the motivation, has the time to develop the business model and really tease out what it would take to get a certain technology to the market. And a lot of times it's not the professor at a university because they're overloaded with all of their other responsibilities. A lot of times it's a PhD student or a postdoc or another person who's intimately involved in the technology, knows the science, but has that entrepreneurial bug. And so that's kind of what I did as a postdoc was I did an iCorps program. It was actually through NIH at the Cleveland Clinic, but we followed the same structure. Unfortunately, it didn't come with that $50,000, which would have been nice, but it was still very valuable, the lessons learned nonetheless. So I think it's important to have that person. And as the company kind of matures, a lot of times you kind of replace that that entrepreneur lead with a real CEO that either has experience or is supplemented with experience from advisors. I also think the second key person in kind of a startup space is more of the COO or the operational person. The entrepreneurial lead kind of has the vision, has the strategy. Their role is raising money, but you really need to have that person who, you know, takes that vision and implements it and gets the work done. So I'd say really those two key pieces are critical for getting a startup off the ground.
Great, thank you for that. Mm-hmm. So Trina, this next question is for you. You have a distinguished track record of receiving grant funding both in academia and in the startup world. What are some of the major insights to writing a successful proposal?
Thank you. Yeah. You know, I was fortunate enough to have received the NSF iCorps, the NSF PFI grants, and also some other agencies for seed funding with technology like Coulter Foundation, the QED University Science Center, those funding as well. And we're currently seeking SBIR for technology development. Yeah, so, you know, successful proposals, I think whether I'm a faculty. So again, whether it's research, which is what we do a lot of, right? Research proposals, basic research proposals, or more technology development, kind of translational things. It's choosing the right agency, you know, making sure it's the right request for proposals based on the technology that you're developing and at what stage it is that you're developing. So whether you're gonna go out for seed funding or more substantial funding from these agencies, you really have to know kind of what data, you know, feasibility data or proof of concept data you may or may not have. So it's really kind of knowing that, knowing your audience, because the reviewers are gonna be looking at and critiquing your proposal based kind of on those things. And then it's really leading with a really good understanding with the market need, and how your technology will address that. And so, you know, when you're writing these proposals, that first page, that whether it's NSF, like a project summary, or if it's the NIH, it's that specific aims page, those things, right? For you guys who are really in this, that's got to be really clear and concise as to what the need is and how your technology will develop it. And, you know, and so, and I can't emphasize, again, demonstrating some level of feasibility. Otherwise, the reviewers will really have some difficulty with that. And having others review your proposal ahead of time, you know, rely on others. If you've got, again, faculty and a part of these programs, you generally have a business mentor, you've got your postdoc or PhD working on things as you go into these proposals, but, you know, try to have others review that have had successful proposals so they know what to look for. If they're able to share their proposals, even better, that helps. in terms of just being able to see how successful things are written and the, even the kind of the language, even though it may be totally unrelated to what you're developing, it just is helpful. And finally, don't give up with these proposals, because I've certainly gotten a lot of rejections before things are funded. And, you know, all that hard work that goes into these proposals, you know, it's worthwhile. You may say, wow, I spent so much time and then it's not funded, but you can always recycle those things and look for the right, you know, agency or call again that fits better, especially if you don't have any proof of concept data. You may have to go for, again, kind of the node little $3,000 funding, but that can get you closer to that data that's needed to move to a more substantial funding from these agencies. So
that was some great advice, Trina, and I echo that about having to apply again sometimes. I would ask one more question, and it's a quick one. How much lead time do the entrepreneurs need to prepare some of these proposals?
Yeah, it can vary, but it's hard to tell exactly, because again, it depends on your ability, and then if it's a team effort in the ability to write these things. And so you want to give yourself as much time as possible with that deadline. You don't want to do something quickly within a week's time or even 2 weeks' time. Exactly. Usually, you know, it's a month plus, you know, to prepare these things well. So
great. Thank you for that. Krista, you're up. Tell me, what was the impact of grant funding for the startups of which you've been involved?
Major impact. So for Haima Therapeutics, we are majority grant funded at this point. We've brought in over $8 million in non-dilutive funding from NIH, NSF, and DOD.
So you did get your $50,000.
We did, yeah, and other sources, but every penny counts. Another extra 50K would have been nice. You know, we started small with more translational grants that are available in the academic setting. So Coulter funding, the NIH NCAI funding, our state of Ohio has some translational startup funding, small, you know, 25, 50K here and there to do some of those key proof of concept studies and generate the data that could then be used to support the SBIR type grant application. So then we use that preliminary data, put in several SBIRs through NSF, NIH, and DOD, which ended up getting funded, and not the first time, you know, there's always resubmission. So you have to keep in mind this time that it takes to actually bring money in. And then we've also leveraged DOD funding that is not through the SBIR program, but they have more specific calls for certain technologies to address various challenges within the military. And our technology is a synthetic platelet to treat bleeding. So it's right up their alley, and there's multiple sources of funding that are open to industry as well as academia. So that's been our start in HIMA. In Allen Air Therapeutics, we've also brought in a little over $2 million in non-dilutive funding. So it's crucial to get the early stage proof of concept and early de-risking data in hand that could then attract the follow-on funding from more institutional investors such as angels, you know, pre-seed funds, and even larger VCs. So it's a great way to de-risk the technology, get some of that key data in hand that then you can leverage for further follow-on, you know, investments.
Excellent answer. So Andre, this next question is for you. As you mentioned earlier, even with your current university position, you're an entrepreneur. Can you share some of the insight or what it's like to be an operator building a venture versus being on the academic side where you're now partly responsible for championing innovation?
So a great question. You know, I'd like to echo a few of the other points that have been made. You know, as an entrepreneur and being in academia, so I'm currently a professor at George Mason, previously a professor at University of Maryland. Excuse the background noise there. You know, it becomes clear really early that to most academics that they're not going to leave their university position, they're not going to give up tenure, and they're going to need to rely on a team in order to commercialize their technology. And so the point that Krista made earlier about postdocs and PhD students being so early on, being so important in your nascent venture, I think that's really a key point. And I have to make a point about IP and whether you are whether you're a student or whether you're a faculty member, sorting out your IP is so important. If that IP is not sorted out, there's no way you can do business, right? Because ultimately, we need to know anyone who's going to engage with you is going to need to know if you have intellectual property or not, and if it's maybe. Okay, do you have a provisional patent? Have you disclosed any discovery? All that, and I'm not saying that it has to be, it doesn't have to be finished, but it needs to be considered. You need to have a thoughtful response to how you are handling the business of your intellectual property. So that's important. And then there's a whole emotional side of your IP that academics, whether you're a student or whether you're a faculty member, get all caught up in with regard to ownership of the IP. And yes, it is your idea. Absolutely, it's yours, it's your baby. At the same time, if you're using university resources, you have to consult with the university to see how the university engages with its students and with its faculty members on the ownership of IP. Generally, in my experience, whether it's at my current institution or previous institutions, universities want you to do the hard work of commercializing your technology. And so their intellectual property policies are liberal to give you ownership and often to give
incentivize that behavior.
Yeah, I would say to give you the support that you need, as well as to give you the licenses that you may need for the intellectual property, and in some cases to give you ownership. Universities allow their students to own their IP. So they're liberal. They want you to commercialize the technology. They want you to be successful. And so that needs to be sorted. So, I mentioned IP. I mentioned the need to have partners like your students that are really spinning out the company. And so those are kind of key insights and struggles that I had that I did the wrong way. As an early entrepreneur and academic. And so I'm kind of on the other side, hoping to share some of my, learned some of my, some of, share some of my insights that I learned from my mistakes with my current stakeholders throughout the university, my faculty, students, and so forth. And I think just the biggest idea there is that the key insight is that most of the, whether it was entrepreneurship or other translational activities that I was involved in, they all happened by mistake. Even going to graduate school, all of this stuff were things that I hadn't expected to do. And so probably at the, 50,000 foot level, I'm just trying to create opportunities for faculty and students to have rich experiences that they may not be looking for, they may not know about, and they may not have opportunities to engage in, because we all have our heads down, right? Faculty and students, which, you know, being a researcher that's focused on discovery, it's all consuming. And we have our heads down and oftentimes are unaware of all of these other rich pathways that may lead us in a different direction or may even enrich the direction that we're on. And so, you know, it's maybe kind of a very general answer, but I really do look for opportunities to attract faculty and students outside of their day-to-day focus on their discovery in hopes that they'll have a new experience that may be translational or otherwise that may enrich and expand on their view of what it means to be a researcher and what researchers do.
Great, thanks, Andre. I look forward to the programming you're gonna put on at George Mason to pull out the commercialization in your faculty. So one other thing in common with every panelist here, we've all been involved in a startup at some point in time. So I'm gonna open this up to everyone, and Trina, I'm gonna start with you. What do you know now that you wish you would have known when you began your journey as an entrepreneur?
Okay, sorry, I had to mute it. Well, again, it's just, it's the knowing a little bit more about, at least in my area, the kind of medical device and this orthopedics area, it's very competitive. So, I mean, in terms of the number of products that are out there and things like that. So it was still, I think we didn't assess as well as we should have the competition and our competitive advantage in some of our technology. So it's been a little bit of that kind of struggle, I think, when we started, in particular, this type of the company that we've started in this specific technology, and that it's just very, very competitive market.
So, understood.
So it's just knowing that a little bit better.
All right, thank you. Yeah. Christina?
Sure. I wish we all knew our competition and markets a little bit better, right? It'd be great to have some crystal balls and figure that out. I do think, though, that there is a certain mentality that you have to embrace to be a successful entrepreneur, and anyone can embrace that mentality. I don't think entrepreneurs are made, or rather born. I think that they are, there's some inherent qualities that make you more likely to want to be an entrepreneur or to be successful at it, but everyone can cultivate entrepreneurship, in my mind, at least. I know that some VCs especially feel very differently. So I think, you know, knowing what I know now, it really is embracing the wild ride that it is in being in a startup. Our startup is a platform technology that can upcycle plant waste into different materials, different chemicals, and that can be used in a number of different markets or industries. Initially, our team was focused on the inventors. They actually went through I-Corps and the national program in late 2019, and they were focused on flavors and fragrances at that point. There was a little blip of time where they were looking into adhesives, and then they pivoted into cosmetics, specifically clean beauty. And that's kind of where I got involved. I was like, oh, this is interesting. It fits my personal interests as well as, you know, technical interests. And then we pivoted by chance back into adhesives. So, I mean, it's kind of like head jerky, right? We were doing customer discovery in the cosmetic space. We had just won a grant to support that from VentureWell. We were, you know, I think we'd done like 30 interviews, and then we got a phone call from an adhesives company that we had talked to some time ago. And they said, hey, we're interested in sustainability now, as opposed to a year and a half ago. And so, you know, we had some conversations with them. There's interest there. And since then we've sold, you know, we've had some revenue coming in this year, which is exciting. And I think if we had only said, our vision is to sell into X market and that's what we're going to do, you know, we don't want to have any conversations with anyone else, that kind of thing, you know, then we wouldn't have had the traction that we have to date. The other side of it too is on the funding side. So there's the market alignment side, and there's the funding side. up until a couple weeks ago, we were starting to look at doing some investor discovery, and we had signed up for PitchBook through the lab space that we're at. They have a PitchBook account. We didn't pay for that ourselves. And we started to look at who could potentially be our investors because we knew we had limited runway, and our some of our co-founders need to get paid at some point in the near future. They're younger than I am. They're, you know, grad student, postdoc. They
don't need any pay. They can work for free.
Tell them that. So we were starting to look at getting investment, and then ta-da, we win a huge DOE grant. And then, so now we don't need to worry about investment, which is great. So I think it's just kind of like every week is something new is happening and we're adapting and being, you know, coachable at all times. So it really is, I mean, I think it's just a lesson learned that you have to be able to pivot. You have to be able to listen to what the market is telling you, follow the customer pull more than anything, and write a lot of proposals. Because not all of them hit, and when they do, it's really fun. I think that's probably the best advice I could give.
Okay, Christina, you use some NSF I-Corps jargon, pivot. Just in case our audience doesn't know what that means, please elaborate in 30 seconds.
So the official I-Corps definition is a pivot is a change to one or more aspects of your business model. So maybe you pivoted and by way of going into a different market like we did, or maybe you pivot your value proposition as in you are still in the cosmetic space or, you know, still in the adhesive space, but now we're offering X value instead of Y. So it's just changing some aspect of your business.
Okay, great. Thank you. And Krista, so what are some of the common barriers or misunderstandings that can slow down or stop a successful funding opportunity?
I think the biggest thing is the change in mindset from a more academic proposal to a technology business focused proposal. It's not about what the next kind of cool experiment is. It's about what are the key experiments to show that this technology has a chance to compete in the particular market that you're trying to enter. So making sure you're comparing to standard of care, making sure that you're, you know, designing your experiments and your studies to actually focus on the product development and not just, you know, focus on the science. I think that's a key mistake that we've made, you know, putting our first proposals in versus the proposals that we put in now. I also think a major thing, you know, non-dilutive funding has been fantastic for my companies, but not everything is covered from non-dilutive funding. And there's a barrier for growing the company if you don't have access to other sources of funding to be able to pay for the things that are not covered by grants, like legal. I mean, legal is so expensive. I can never fathom how much it costs for an hour of somebody's time and how many hours it takes to get certain agreements in place. And you want to do it right the first time, or else you're just going to spend tens of thousands of dollars redoing it later on. So really understanding the supplemental funding that's required.
Thanks, Krista. And Andre, could you tell us about the same question, but from the NSF side? What did you all see with the people writing in? What were some of the barriers that they didn't get funding and you had to counsel them about doing X, Y, or Z next time for a better proposal?
So yes, a really good question. So I loved your statement about kind of focusing on commercial, you know, the commercial potential and focus on how you're going to be successful commercially compared to what's scientifically interesting. That was a really great point. From NSF perspective, you know, my mind is racing. There's a lot of things. Okay, you know. This is going to sound horrible, but I'm going to say it. Read the solicitation, okay?
Reading is fundamental? Are you serious? No.
It's really, really important. Those solicitations, they do kind of seem cryptic, you know, and they're pretty boring, but there's so much work that went into that solicitation to describe the program and trying to really understand the intent of what the agency wants. You know, if there's a way that you can, even if you don't understand the solicitation, ask questions and look for opportunities to get the intent from the program directors. What is this program all about? And then embrace that intent and align yourself with the program. There's so many people that, so many PIs that try to pull the agency in their direction. Think about that for a second. It's not gonna happen. You're not gonna pull the agency. You're not gonna get the agency to become interested, you know, if it's not already aligned with what they're doing. So understanding what the agency's intent is, what their priorities are, what they're trying to accomplish in that program, in that solicitation, and then looking for opportunities for overlapping interests with what you're trying to do is, you know, that's how you win.
That's some excellent advice, and I hope that everyone out there is paying attention. And with that, we are at the end of the plan discussion. Anne-Marie, tell us about the Q&A.
Yeah, so we have lots of questions that have come in, very practical questions, which reflects the conversation so far. The first one, let me read off from Michael. Michael Ehrlich asks, you focused on the entrepreneurial lead and the technical lead roles. What makes for a great iCorps mentor? And how do you recruit them and encourage them to participate in the national teams boot camp?
All right, Christina, I'm going to give that one to you.
Sure. So I think there's a few things that make a good mentor. The most important is that they need to be able to have personality to lead from behind. And I'm sure that wouldn't be an expected answer, but I mean, if a person is in the industry in some way, either they're an entrepreneur or they're an entrepreneur at a company, or maybe they're even an investor, although that's more rare. That's all great, but I mean, and that's what you want to find in a mentor. But the most important trait that makes or breaks a good mentor is they need to be able to lead from behind. What does that mean? They can't be the entrepreneurial lead. They can't be pulling the team forward. They can't be doing the interviews for the team. They can't be telling the team what, you know, the market needs. They need to be able to support. It's an educational program first and foremost. Support your entrepreneurial lead, your grad student who's, you know, going to be a grad student, maybe a postdoc. Support him or her to learn themselves, you know, what the market is telling them, but also the soft skills that come along with that. Reaching out to people, doing cold calls, you know, maybe using their resources like LinkedIn or others to get a hold of people. It's not easy to do 100 interviews in 7 weeks. You're going to need the mentor's help to get that done. And obviously we would love a mentor who comes to the table with a great Rolodex or whatever the 2021 version of a Rolodex is. You know, so that's a great asset, but it's not the primary thing you're looking for. You're looking for someone who can really help you over the long term, who has, you know, some good connection with the, especially the entrepreneurial lead. So someone who's available, they need to commit at least 15 hours a week during the 7-week program. I mean, that's important. You can't miss a single webinar or otherwise the whole team's in trouble and you don't want to be in trouble with the NSF. they need to be able to have that, you know, supportive nature. They need to have some understanding of what it means to do entrepreneurship. That could be very broad, but, you know, if they're an entrepreneur themselves or, you know, have been an entrepreneur in the past, entrepreneur, et cetera. And, you know, I think that they understand the purpose of this is to learn. It's really about learning. It's not about launching a successful startup. It's about teaching the team how to do a systematic analysis of, is there a market potential here? Do customers value this technology? So I think that that's, I'll leave it at that. I'm sure others have best practices as well. But
I think that was a great answer. And just quickly, when I did iCorps as a part of cohort number 2, I had a mentor. And at that point in time, I wanted Tom to come run my company. I wanted to be the CSO, allow him to run the company, but in the background, he was building me up and giving me those skills that I needed to eventually become the president and CEO of Affinity. And it's the perfect example of leading from behind. He knew it. He was doing it all the time. I had no clue, but it was a great experience. Anne-Marie?
Great. The second question, Trina, this comes directly to you. Can Dr. Arenze tell us anything about her device as an example of a successful project?
Yeah, sure. I mean, so yeah, the technology that we've now developed, like I said, I'm co-founder of a company. It's actually a bone, what's called a bone graft biomaterial device. So it actually is used to replace what's currently on the market, which is the use of bone grafts. So these are a cadaver bone, you know, or autographed material. And so it's to use as like a bone void filler. So if you have skeletal defects or if you have spine fusion, this is the material that would be used or put in place to regenerate bone. So we've been able to demonstrate, and this is important, I guess, in proposals. And this is what I meant by how these how competitive the market is. You have to be able to demonstrate superiority against other devices that are currently on the market. And there's quite a bit of in this bone product space. So we've been able to show that and kind of proof of concept data that we are superior than some of the other products or one product on the market right now. And so to be able to carry that forward. So we're actually going right now, we have a proposal in for a fast track phase one, phase two SBIR grant through the NIH. So we're crossing our fingers.
Good luck.
Next question comes from Yatin. Hi, Yatin. Universities always find it difficult to identify good business or industry mentors that could work well with university faculty and mentors. Can you recommend good sources to find appropriate mentors who work well with academic innovators in the region, other than reaching out to Christina every time to ask if she knows?
So I'll begin on that one. Panelists, feel free to chime in. It is a really challenging thing, and you have to find different mentor type organizations. Like here at the University of Delaware, we have an organization called STRIDE, and they're one of the organizations that has expressed interest with working with the university faculty. So we try to find value propositions that align for both entities, and that's typically where you can get some magic to happen. But it's you have to do it with intentionality and realize that it may not work. It may be the wrong mentor and that you may need to make some changes. And as a part of a couple other organizations that I'm involved with, this mentorship thing is so difficult and challenging. And so now we're actually going to be working or trying to work with the federal government to be able to help us to be able to pay for assistance from some of these mentors, especially when you're talking about mentors that are from underrepresented groups. When I started doing entrepreneurship, there was nobody that looked like me in the room. I couldn't find a mentor that looked like me, and we realized how important that is. So now we're trying to do some things to help move the needle. But it's also really engaging your alumni on database. I just had an alum call me yesterday to ask me how he saw the info about the hub. He wants to know how he can get involved in mentor people. So, you have to pound the pavement, but I think there are definitely some avenues that will seed success.
Great. Let's go to the next one. Can you share some numbers of how impactful ICOR has been? Do companies that go through ICOR do better, such as they raise more funds, launch a successful product, or other measures of success?
You're smiling, Andre, you know that's coming to you.
So thanks for that question. Wow, you know, you are putting my memory to the test because I am now in a new context with a new set of challenges and a new pitch. ICOR is a successful program. I would encourage you to look at our two AICA reports, American Innovation and Competitiveness Act reports, that are easily found on the web that provide key metrics for the number of startups. So about 50% or roughly of our teams post ICOR become companies. And our follow-on funding for ICOR teams is really in the hundreds of millions of dollars, right? So we've had 2,000 teams come through ICOR. And so it's successful in terms of commercialization and the intent of the program. It does a great job in changing your or adjusting your focus towards the market. It helps with commercialization of your technologies and your and specifically the commercialization portion of your SBIR proposal, if you choose to write an SBIR proposal. So there are many benefits, and the kind of the biggest one for me is it just makes you a more informed thought leader as an academic, because you're starting to allow, you know, the market to impact the way that you view your research. And you start, you know, we use a term use inspired. So you start having a use inspired view of the things that you're doing in the lab.
Excellent. Thanks, Andre. Audience, thank you for the wonderful questions. Please thank my fellow panelists with me. You all were great. Happy to work with you. And feel free to reach out to us on social media and make sure you join the next session. Thank you for your time.